Okay, we're carrying on. We were off last week. David was speaking, and we're continuing our series here of the Bible and Homosexual Conduct. And 2 weeks ago, we finished looking at what the Old Testament has to say on the subject of homosexual conduct. And we saw from the creation of male and female in Genesis chapter 2 that marriage and the sexual intimacy that are part of it are intended by God to be between those two sexes, those complementary sexes that He created in the beginning. And we saw that divine intention of male-female sexual union. We saw it implied, assumed, and stated explicitly in various other Old Testament texts. And I hope you can now better understand what's behind the statement I read to you some weeks ago from Brevard Childs, who he's dead now, but he was a longtime professor and a longtime professor of Old Testament, very influential Old Testament scholar, where Childs said, the recent attempt of some theologians to find a biblical opening, if not warrant, for the practice of homosexuality stands in striking disharmony with the Old Testament's understanding of the relation of male and female. The theological issue goes far beyond the citing of occasional texts which condemn the practice. The Old Testament views homosexuality as a distortion of creation which falls into the shadows outside the blessing. And so I'm hoping, having gone through the Old Testament text, that this will have a new impact for you, that you can see what motivates him to say such a thing. That it's not simply one little piece here or there, it's contrary to the entire scheme of creation, God's plan, His making of male and female. And then we saw after, we looked at the Old Testament text, went through that, and then we saw that ancient Jews understood the Old Testament the same way. That's where we were when we ended 2 weeks ago. The ancient Jews saw the text the same way, as excluding all forms of homosexual conduct. And just to give you one of the sources that I quoted there, Old Testament scholar Michael Brown, he says, every single reference to homosexual practice in the ancient Jewish world is 100% negative, sometimes in the strongest terms, and there's not a single positive reference to be found. And we looked at some of the texts. I read you some of these are extra-biblical writings outside the Bible, but they show the Jewish understanding of the text. Now, why is it significant? It's significant for two reasons, because as we look at the Old Testament, we come through and I show this is what's being said here. And then we go and we look at how did the ancient Jews understand it, and that their view is the same. They understood that the Old Testament text did in fact preclude all forms of homosexual conduct. So it corroborates our understanding. It's like we're not odd or eccentric. We're not bucking a stream of interpretation. No, no. We see the Old Testament text. They seem to be saying this. The ancient Jews said, yeah, that's right. That's what it's saying. So we are in accord with them. So the first significance of that fact is that it corroborates or confirms that, yes, we're on the right track in understanding the Old Testament. But the second thing why it's significant is that it sets the default perspective of Jesus, the apostles, and the Jewish writers of the New Testament. In other words, since they are Jews, and since Jews in the first century, before, during, and after the first century, unanimously rejected homosexual practice as sinful, and Jesus and the apostles and many of the writers of the New Testament are Jews, now since they are first century Jews, and first century Jews unanimously understood that homosexual conduct was contrary to what God had revealed, well then the default is Jesus and the apostles and the Jewish writers share that perspective unless we have some reason for believing they don't. You see, they're first century Jews. And first century Jews understood the Old Testament the way I've been explaining it to you. So in the absence of some idea saying, no, I don't accept that, well, the default perspective then is that they share that understanding. Okay, that's significant, as you'll see on one of the first claims that people make. All right, this morning we begin looking at the New Testament, what the New Testament has to say on the subject of homosexual conduct. And we begin, naturally enough, with Jesus' view of homosexual conduct. Now, those seeking to legitimize homosexual conduct, to baptize it, to claim that the church must accept it and embrace in its fellowship those who are impenitently engaged in homosexual conduct. They sometimes argue, well, Jesus didn't say anything on the subject. Jesus didn't say anything on the subject. In fact, I heard one person say, here's what Jesus had to say about it, and then just paused and didn't say anything. You see, he didn't say anything about it. And then what they want to draw from that is that somehow then he approved of it. You see, somehow he approved of it. Under their view, he allegedly didn't say anything about it, which is not correct, as we'll see. But this idea, he didn't say anything about it, and then they say, well, so therefore, there's no basis, no reason to believe that he opposed it, but there's much that's wrong with that. In the first place, even if Jesus made no reference to homosexual conduct, even if that were true, which it's not because he refers to it implicitly, as I'm going to explain in a minute, but even if he made no reference to it, his silence cannot reasonably be construed as an endorsement of that behavior. As I just said, given that he's a Jew, and Jews unanimously rejected same-sex intercourse, his silence would mean that he felt no need to challenge or to alter the status quo. How would you jump from his silence in that historical context to a meaning that he rejects the status quo? If he's going to reject the status quo, he's a first-century Jew, he's going to have to say something. Silence certainly wouldn't get you to that position. I mean, that'd be like saying Jesus was approving of bestiality and incest because he didn't address it. Well, would anybody say that? No. Nobody would say that. Well, here's all he said about bestiality. Okay, well, therefore he endorsed it. Nobody says that. Why? Because they understand that in the historical context, his silence can't be construed that way. Okay? And besides that, as we'll see, the Apostle Paul clearly disapproves of homosexual conduct. So if you interpret Jesus' alleged silence as his endorsement or approval of homosexual conduct in the face of Paul's disapproval of that same conduct, well, then you create a contradiction, a conflict between Jesus and the Spirit who inspired Paul to write what he wrote. And we know there is no contradiction or conflict between Jesus and the Spirit because they are both persons of the Godhead. So that idea of silence that people try to ride, I have to say, sometimes I just don't understand how some things get traction. Because that to me is just so patently absurd in principle. But yet I hear it talking. People think it's deep. And I just go, well, I don't know. Maybe I've lost my mind. All right. Second thing I want to say about Jesus' view of homosexual conduct is he did refer implicitly to homosexual conduct in Mark chapter 7, verses 21 to 23, in the parallel in Matthew 15, verse 18 to 20. And here's the text. It says, for from within, out of people's hearts, come evil thoughts, sexual immoralities, sometimes translated fornications, it's a plural of the word porneia, thefts, murders, adulteries, greed, evil actions, deceit, promiscuity, stinginess, blasphemy, pride, and foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile a person. Jesus refers implicitly to homosexual conduct, where he in this text where he included this sexual immoralities, this plural form of the word porneia, and licentiousness, or the way the Christian Standard Bible translates it, promiscuity. Here he includes those things in a list of things that are evil and defiling. Now, why do I think that homosexual conduct is encompassed in this plural of porneia? Well, the word that's used, porneia, in the first century, it was a very broad term encompassing all unlawful sexual intercourse. If you look at the standard Greek lexicon, okay, which gives the meaning of the Greek words in the first century as used in the Bible, you will see its meaning is unlawful sexual intercourse. It's a very broad term that is used. And you can see the breadth of the term. in a writing, The Testament of Benjamin, I mentioned a couple weeks ago, 9.1, it's a century or so before Jesus said these words recorded in Mark. And in Testament of Benjamin 9.1, you see there that the word porneia, he uses porneia to refer to the sexual immorality of the Sodomites. So he uses the word there referring to their sexual immorality, embracing homosexual conduct in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18, the word porneia is there used to describe the sin of incest and having sex with a prostitute, respectively, in 5:1 and 6:18. So you see the breadth of the word, unlawful sexual intercourse. In Jude, verse 7, you see there's a related verb. Porneia is a noun. Well, in Jude, verse 7, he uses a related verb, ekpornuo. Porneia, ekpornuo. You see, it's a related verb, and he uses that in Jude 7 in association with the men of Sodom going after strange flesh, which, as I said a couple weeks ago, most recognize that that's a reference to homosexual conduct. So you have this idea. It's not strange to be seeing when Jesus speaks of porneia, when he speaks of the plural form of that, that he's referring in something that encompasses homosexual conduct. Here's what Robert Gagnon, he's that New Testament scholar who's written a great deal on this subject. His book is The Bible and Homosexual Practice. He says, no first century Jew could have spoken of porneiae, that's the plural, without having in mind the list of forbidden sexual offenses in Leviticus 18 and 20, incest, adultery, same-sex intercourse, bestiality. In this particular saying, the sin of adultery in Mark 7, the sin of adultery is listed separately, so the plural likely has incest most in view, along with same-sex intercourse and bestiality, probably also fornication and prostitution. You see, you can't just rip these things out of their historical setting. So when Jesus says that, he doesn't say anything. No, he did implicitly. You see, he's covering it when he says something like that, sexual immoralities. And if somebody says no, they won't accept that for an answer despite how reasonable it is. If somebody says no, I'm going to insist that even though porneia is a broad term and even though it's used in the plural, I'm going to insist that the reference here is to a form or forms of heterosexual immorality only. Well, even if somebody takes that position, well, then certainly licentiousness or promiscuity covers the rest of the waterfront in terms of sexual immorality. Certainly it covers the rest of the waterfront. I pointed out some weeks ago that the word that she translated here, promiscuity, or oftentimes licentiousness, it means self-abandonment or a lack of self-restraint, especially in regard to sexual excesses. And you see it in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7, says that Lot was distressed by the licentious conduct of the lawless men of Sodom and Gomorrah. So why would you think that Jesus is excluding from the reach of that word? You see, that's that special pleading. It's because you don't want it to be in there. I'm interested in what's reasonably there. I want to know what the text is really saying. I don't want to come with an agenda and say, is there some way I can crowbar this thing out? I want to say, what's it saying? And as I look at this, it's saying to me, pretty obviously, that it is encompassing that. So when people say, well, Jesus didn't say anything about that, that's not quite right. You see, it's not quite right. He doesn't specifically come out and say that, but he encompasses it in this word. Third thing I want to say about Jesus' view of homosexual conduct is you see in his discussion that I've mentioned before, when we talked about Genesis 1 and 2, you see in his discussion in Matthew chapter 19, verses 4 and 6, his discussion of divorce there. Well, there he appealed to both Genesis 1:27, where it says God made them male and female, and he appeals to Genesis 2:24, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and will be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So you see how he does it. He made them male and female, therefore, And I spent a lot of time talking about that. See, that the woman is the sexual complement she's created out of the man. And therefore, they rejoin. You see. And so he says, therefore, the two shall become one flesh. So he cites 127, goes to 224, and then he adds, so they're no longer two but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let man not separate. And see, this shows that Jesus accepted the model for marriage and sexual union that is presented. I mean, it doesn't surprise you that Jesus accepted it. I mean, he's God the Son. But it shows you that he accepted the model for marriage and sexual union that's presented in Genesis chapters 1 and 2, that he understood that marriage was ordained by God as the union of a man and woman, not a man and another man, not a woman and another woman. See, there was no need for him to comment directly on homosexual unions because the creation text authorized only one type of sexual union, male and female. So here you see, that on this point you see, on his view, you see this is relevant to Jesus' understanding of the issue. The fourth thing about Jesus' view on homosexual conduct I want to bring up is Jesus in Matthew chapter 19. Matthew chapter 19, verses 11 and 12, he responds to the disciples' comment. Now, we sometimes, I think, get twisted around on what's going on here. But he responds to the disciples' comment in verse 10 that it's better not to marry. Now, see, they made that statement in reaction to Jesus' restrictive teaching on divorce and remarriage regarding a husband and wife in Matthew chapter 19, verses 1 to 9. Jesus gives this restrictive teaching in Matthew 19, 1 to 9, on the divorce and remarriage of a husband and a wife. And after that, in light of that, the disciples then say, well, given that, it's better not to marry. You know, given that those restrictions, it's better not to marry. And then Jesus tells them in response to that statement, he tells them in verse 11, not everyone can receive this saying, referring to their statement, that it's better not to marry. Not everybody can receive that statement, but only those to whom it is given, meaning those who are given the gift of celibacy, the ability to live without sexual intercourse. It's not given to everybody. Not everybody can handle being unmarried. I hear you saying that, but you have to have a caution to that because not everybody can handle the state of being unmarried because the state of being unmarried is a celibate state. You understand that? There is no sexual activity outside of a heterosexual marriage. All other sexual activity outside of that relationship is immoral. So what are the choices? The choices are heterosexual marriage or celibacy. Those are the only alternatives that Jesus contemplates. And so that's why he says when they say, well, if that's the case, it's better not to marry. Oh, you have to understand in saying that not everybody can handle the celibate state that is inherent in being unmarried. You remember the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7? He wishes that all had his gift of freedom from the need of sexual fulfillment. That's what Paul is saying in 1 Corinthians 7, 7. He wishes that all had the gift of that he has of freedom from the need of sexual fulfillment that made it possible for him to live unmarried, but he knows that everybody doesn't. Everybody doesn't have that. And so when you go around saying, well, it's better not to marry, you need to understand what you're saying. You see, and that's what's going on here in verse 12. That's what Jesus is talking about in verse 12. He says, some cannot experience sexual relations because of some birth defect. Those born eunuchs. Some cannot experience sexual relations because they've been castrated, made eunuchs by men. And some cannot experience sexual relations because they've chosen not to marry so as to devote themselves to ministry, made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. So he's talking about here, you see, that there is this celibacy, this absence of sexual relations. And so when you say that it's better not to marry, you need to understand that not everybody's cut out for that. Not everybody can handle that. So what you wind up doing, if you don't get married and you're not able to live that way, what happens? You then go into sexual immorality, and that's death. Okay, so I want you to see the point for the purpose, what we're talking about, is that the only alternatives that Jesus contemplates are heterosexual marriage and celibacy, unmarried. Those two are the same, because sex outside of a marriage state is immoral. Okay, so what's he seeing there? No homosexual conduct. You see, if there was a third door, then he wouldn't have to caution them about that, because the unmarried state wouldn't put pressure on somebody because they could find release in an immoral relationship. That's why he's saying it's only heterosexual marriage or celibacy. There's nothing out here. You can't go out and be sexually immoral to obtain that release. So either you are able to live a celibate life, or it's marriage. So I think that's important to see, that Jesus is getting at these questions and these issues in a different way, not as directly as somebody who's bent on saying, well, I want him to say this explicitly. I want to know what he's saying. Implicitly, explicitly, whatever he's saying. That's what I'm trying to hear. Okay, now the fifth thing and the final thing I want to mention about Jesus' view of homosexual conduct is finally, he didn't come to abolish the law or the prophets, but to fulfill them. Part of which involves an intensifying of the moral obligations of the Old Testament by drawing out their deepest intention. You see, part of this idea, when he says, I didn't come to abolish, but to fulfill them, part of that fulfilling is his intensifying of the moral requirements of the Old Testament by drawing out their deepest intention. So the ban on murder extends to the anger that gives rise to it. The ban on adultery extends to lusting in one's heart. The ban on false swearing extends to taking oaths. The ban on excessive retaliation extends to turning the other cheek. And the requirement to love one's neighbor is said to encompass what? Loving one's enemies. You see, so there is this intensification of moral, holy living by drawing out the deepest intentions that are buried in these commands. He draws them out. He intensifies them. Now, given that pattern of intensification of moral requirements, the claim that Jesus did the opposite regarding the Old Testament's ban on homosexual conduct, that he lifted that proscription. Well, that's going to require some clear and convincing proof. You can't just say that. That's going to require some clear and convincing proof. And there is none, and in fact, there's powerful evidence to the contrary, as I've just tried to sketch. There's powerful evidence to the contrary. Gagnon says the portrayal of Jesus as a first century Palestinian Jew who was open to homosexual practice is simply ahistorical. In other words, it's got him somewhere else. It takes him out of his historical context. It's dreaming. Is ahistorical. All the evidence leads in the opposite direction. Why then did Jesus not make an explicit statement against homosexual conduct? The obvious answer is that Jesus did not encounter any openly homosexual people in his ministry and therefore had no need to call anyone to repentance for such homosexual conduct. He also did not address other sexual issues, such as incest and bestiality. But that hardly indicates a neutral or positive stance on such matters. What is clear from the evidence that the texts do offer is that the historical Jesus is no defender of homosexual behavior. To the contrary, Jesus, both in what he says and what he fails to say, remains squarely on the side of those who reject homosexual practice. Jesus says and makes clear that he stands right in the stream of Judaism that understands from the Old Testament that homosexual conduct is contrary to the creative intent and purpose of God. He's not the least bit aberrational in that regard. Okay, so all this stuff that you hear, what I wanted to do in the class is I want people to know what's going on. So when they hear this stuff, they go, no. And even if they don't recall all the details, they know, I know there's something I need to look into because that doesn't sound right. Okay, if you walk away with that, I'll be happy because I have no illusions about, you know, what you accomplish in this. But if you walk away with that, I'll be happy. Let me talk about Paul's view of homosexual conduct. So we looked at the Old Testament. We looked at how the Jews before, during, and after the first century, how they saw it. We see that it corroborates our understanding and also sets the default perspective of Jesus, the apostles, and the Jewish writers of the New Testament. We then started looking at the New Testament. We look at Jesus' view. And there are five reasons to say that, no, he stands right in the stream of the Jewish view of homosexual conduct. Now I want to look at the Apostle Paul. And Paul's condemnation of homosexual conduct in Romans chapter 1, verses 24 through 32, I could just go to that text, but I don't like doing that. You have to see how somebody's writing. If you can't follow the flow of thought in something, it's just too easy to be hoodwinked. Because you can pull text out and make them say something which in the flow of the argument you say, well, that's not really what he's saying. Okay, so I want to back up a couple of sections and quickly give you what I think is going on there. And the first, the theme of the letter of Romans is given, of course, in Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. We're going to Romans 1, 24 to 32. That's where I'm headed. But I want you to see the flow of thought when we get there. So when I just summarize and tell you what's going on there, you look at it and say, okay, he's tracking correctly. All right. That way you say, I'm hearing the word of God. You see, if you can see that and say, okay, that's right. That's God's message. That's not the dude's message standing up there. That's God's message. And the only way to do that is to bring you through so that it is your conviction that you say, that's what the Bible's saying. Okay. That's what I work at. But here he says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, both to the Jew first and to the Greek, for in it the righteousness of God is being revealed, a righteousness from faith to faith, just as it is written, but the righteous from faith shall live. Now some apparently, this Paul gives really the theme of the letter here, a wide recognition of that. Some apparently saw Paul's absence from Rome as an indication that he was ashamed of the gospel he preached. Or Paul was concerned that some would see it that way. Whether they're actually doing it or Paul is just concerned they're going to be viewing him as being ashamed of coming of the gospel he preaches. Either some are doing it or Paul's concerned about that. Maybe they thought he was embarrassed to preach the gospel in such a sophisticated city. Right? I mean, after all, Paul does say in 1 Corinthians 1:23 that Christ crucified is foolishness to Gentiles. So maybe you have something, and look, Paul is okay. He's out here in the backwaters because the people in Rome saw themselves as what? We're like the center of the cosmos. I mean, we're really the intellectual elite. And this stuff is okay maybe out here, but Paul's not really willing to bring it to the intellectual heart of civilization and try his stuff here. Maybe that's what it was when they thought that he's ashamed of it. Or maybe they thought Paul was embarrassed to preach the gospel in a Christian community where elements of that community saw it as anti-law or anti-Jewish. Now see, that would be very difficult argument to make an anti-law or an anti-Jewish argument in light of the old covenant scriptures. So maybe they thought that Paul was unwilling to come to Rome and face close questioning on those particular issues. But in any event, whatever was behind that suspicion or Paul's concern about that suspicion, that whatever was behind that suspicion that Paul's absence from Rome reflected a sense of shame or some kind of an intellectual intimidation, Paul flatly says he's not ashamed of the gospel he preaches. Okay, whatever anybody's thinking, he's not ashamed of the gospel he preaches. And the reason he's not ashamed of that gospel is that that gospel, the true gospel, okay, that true gospel is that however it may appear to the world, the truth of the matter, however that gospel may appear to the world, the truth of the matter is that it's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, both to the Jew first and also to the Greek or the Gentile. So Paul says, however it may appear, I'm not ashamed of it because it is the power of God for salvation. Now, the gospel is the power of God for salvation. Why? Because in it, he says, for in it, the righteousness of God is being revealed. In the gospel, it's the power of God for salvation. Why? Because in it, the righteousness of God is being revealed. Now, when righteousness is attributed to God in the Old Testament, when righteousness is attributed to God in the Old Testament, it frequently has reference to his saving activity. You see, when righteousness, it frequently refers to God's saving activity. For example, in Isaiah 46, 13, God promises through the prophet, he says, I bring near my righteousness, it is not far off, and my salvation will not delay. He says in Psalm 98, 2, the Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. And there are numerous other psalms and other texts in Isaiah where you can see that. That frequently, when righteousness is attributed to God in the Old Testament, it has reference to his saving activity. In the preaching of the gospel, God's saving action, God's saving activity is taking place. It's being revealed in history. It's occurring. In the preaching of the gospel, God's saving activity is taking place. And the way it's taking place is through his bestowing of a righteous status on those who believe. In other words, the righteousness of God, here it includes both God's saving activity, his rescuing work, his making right, his saving and vindicating, that element of the righteousness of God from the Old Testament, but it also includes the status of those who are made right. It's an act by which God brings people, he's the actor, he saves them, he brings people into a right relationship with himself. This saving work of righteousing people is, of course, based on the atoning work of Jesus Christ, which is the heart of the gospel. Now, this saving work of God, I'm trying to race through this because I want to get to the section. This saving work of God, this rescuing bestowal of righteousness. You see, this saving work of God, this rescuing bestowal of righteousness is from faith to faith in that it expands with the spreading of faith. This saving work of God, which is this rescuing through the bestowal of righteousness, it tracks the expansion of faith because faith is the means of God's saving work. So it goes like this. You see, it's from faith to faith. Now, in 1:18 to 23, we're not going to do this, are we? I don't think we'll make it, but I'm talking as fast as I can. 1:18 to 23, almost there. Next section is where I'm focusing, okay? He says, For the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth and unrighteousness, because what is noble of God is evident among them. For God displayed it to them. For his invisible attributes, are clearly seen since the creation of the world, being understood by the things made, both his eternal power and deity, so that they are without excuse. Because having known God, they did not glorify him as God or give him thanks, but they became futile in their reasonings, and their uncomprehending hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for a likeness of an image of mortal man and birds and four-footed animals and reptiles. See, that God's saving work, His righteousing of people through faith, is taking place in the preaching of the gospel. That is of supreme importance because, you see, He begins for the wrath of God is being revealed. This idea that, you see, that God's saving work, His righteousing of people through faith, that that's taking place in the preaching of the gospel is of supreme importance because the terrible wrath of God that ultimately is coming is already being previewed. It's already being previewed in His wrath upon ungodliness and unrighteousness of human beings. Now, of course, when we speak about God's wrath, I always like to throw in this footnote. It doesn't mean that He loses His temper. You see, in our culture, you say wrath, and right away, well, I can't deal with a wrathful God. He's got problems. No. You see, it doesn't mean He loses His temper, flies into a rage, or is ever malicious, spiteful, or vindictive. His wrath is His holy hostility to evil, His refusal to condone it or come to terms with it, His just judgment upon it. You see, and Paul makes the point that the wrath of God against sinners, both as previewed in history and as completed on Judgment Day, that that wrath is just and right because God has revealed Himself to all mankind through the creation. He's revealed Himself to all mankind through the creation. I love Thomas Schreiner's statement. He says, God has stitched into the fabric of the human mind His existence and power so that they are instinctively recognized when one views the created world. In other words, I don't think it's a matter of logical deduction. I think it's intuitive. You see, that He's stitched into the mind so that when I see this, so I say, well, let me see your argument. I don't know, but I get it. You see? That's why I like that statement. I think that captures something important. All right, creation bears witness to God, and yet mankind willfully suppresses that testimony, preferring to go its own foolish way and to create its own gods. And then rather than embrace the testimony of God in creation and give Him the glory He's due, humanity culpably represses that truth and substitutes gods of its own making as objects of devotion and reverence. That's what Paul says is going on. Paul's focusing here, of course, on the idolatry. That's the first bell. On the idolatry of the Gentile world. See, a world that had multitude of images that represented these various foreign gods, and that's what you're getting down here, likeness of an image of mortal man, birds, and four-footed things. All right, Paul says in verse 18 that God's wrath is now being manifested from heaven against this culpable suppression and substitution of false gods. His wrath is now being manifested from heaven. Paul, in chapter 1, verses 24 through 32, what I'm focusing on, he explains the form of that wrath that is now being revealed, the form of God's reaction to this human rejection of His revelation. Well, what is the form of that wrath? Paul says in 1:24-32, therefore, because of their culpable suppression and substitution, he says God handed them over. That is a judicial act. It occurs three times in this paragraph. Verses 24, 26, 28. Handed them over. He says, therefore God handed them over in the lusts of their hearts to uncleanness so that their bodies are dishonored among them. They exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature instead of the Creator who is blessed forever. Amen. Because of this, God handed them over to dishonorable passions, for both their females exchanged natural sexual relations for those contrary to nature, and likewise also the males having abandoned natural sexual relations with the female, were inflamed with their desire for one another, males with males, carrying out shameful acts themselves, and receiving in themselves, somehow that got cut off, the necessary penalty for their error. And as they did not see fit to keep God in their knowledge, God handed them over again to an unfit mind to do immoral things. Those filled with all unrighteousness, evil, greed, and depravity, full of envy, murder, discord, deceit, and malice, gossip, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, boastful, devisers of evil, disobedient to parents, and I'm sorry I cut that off. I'll pick it up here. Disobedient to parents, without understanding, without faithfulness, without natural affection, without mercy. They, though knowing God's righteous decree that those who practice such things are worthy of death, not only do them, but also approve of those who practice them. Now that's something, okay? God's wrath is now being expressed, in his opening the door to sinful humanity's headlong plunge into wickedness. This foretaste of wrath in these last days, you understand we're in the last days, have been, but this foretaste of wrath in these last days is God's handing over of human beings to their chosen way of sin and all of its consequences. John Stott says, God abandons stubborn sinners to their willful self-centeredness, and the resulting process of moral and spiritual degeneration is to be understood as a judicial act of God. It's like when the kid is doing something, you finally say, have at it. Go ahead. And then you see the kids spiral down. This is what Paul says God has done. He's opened the door and said, go ahead. And that's part of the judgment, you see. That's part of it. That's what's behind Friedrich Schiller's famous comment, the history of the world is the judgment of the world. As he's opened that door, as God hands them over, we see the depths to which humanity sinks. Their lust finds expression in perverted sex. Exemplified, exhibit A is what? Homosexual conduct. Exhibit A of the extent to which they descend, they spiral, is what? Homosexual conduct. You see, Paul says, homosexuals receive in themselves the necessary penalty for their error. You see, the sexual degradation that they embrace in their rejection of God is punishment itself. It's punishment itself. It's part of God's judgment. Second bell didn't ring, did it? All right. Now, notice that the sinfulness of homosexual conduct, it did now. Next week, Lord willing. But I want you to notice that it's rooted in the creation account. And I'm going to have to go back and reduce these slides. I thought I could blow them up bigger. They look good on my thing, but I see that's not working. Huh? That's all right. I'll just shrink them down, give you guys an eye test. Thanks for coming.